This week's XS with a profile of the ex-Eurythmics lead singer, Annie Lennox, Diva.
Sometimes I've had people actually say in front of me, "She's famous, isn't she?" Right there, you know, like I didn't exist, you know. "She's famous, isn't she?" And they're like, "I don't know, who is she?" You know, and I'm just standing there, you know. It's very, very odd. It's all to do with sort of walls and veils, you know. I had 2 years where I didn't do anything, you know. And in that time, I really was questioning if I should, you know, even think about making a record, you know. And I found that, after all, I'm a musician. After all, I'm a singer. And I have this feeling, in a way, that when I am able to write songs, it sort of affirms who I am. It's caught up with my identity, my sense of self, so that when all of that goes away and it's not happening, I'm feeling like, right, well, what am I supposed to be doing again? Right, well, maybe I should go and be, well, and I start thinking about what I could be, you know, maybe I could be an archaeologist. Well, no, not really, that's not very right. And I think of all these possibilities, and at the end of the day, it all comes back again. You're supposed to write songs, that's what you're meant to do, you know.
Too many times, why don't you ever learn to keep your big mouth shut? That's why it hurts so bad to hear the words that keep on falling from your mouth. Falling from your mouth. Falling from your mouth.
Why is it, in a way, a sort of a very deep dialogue with myself in a funny way? Essentially, it's a kind of song about communication or lack of communication. I start off at the beginning of the song, it's like no makeup, no wonderful clothes, no nothing, no performer, just the person to person. And as this video develops, ultimately the makeup is applied and the diva persona emerges. Ultimately, at the very end, there's a big rant that says, you know, this is the book I never read, these are the words I never said, and I'm sort of, in a way, saying, it's not this, it's not that, I'm not this.
This is the book I never read, these are the words I never said, this is the path I'll never tread, these are the dreams I'm dreaming scared, this is the joy that seldom spread, these are the tears we shed, this is the fear. These are the years of
a denouncement of things that have been applied to me that I feel are not me, you know. And I don't necessarily have to say, but I'm like this. It's just that I am, nobody knows who I am, really. You know? And I reserve that right for what it's worth. When I call the album Diva, it is a little bit ironical because it's quite an arrogant thing to take that name and put it on yourself. It's like taking a crown and putting it on your head in a way. But I do it with a smile because the diva that you see that, you know, which is in the person in performance is not necessarily the person that I am. It's just that as a performer, I've lived that diva-esque existence. Being in a little box and having the box opened up night after night where you come out and perform and everybody sees this thing, this entity, and then you go back and you disappear and pack your suitcase and the person that's you goes to the other town and does the same thing the next night. Well, what happens, I feel, is that person that is the diva gets bigger and bigger, sort of monstrous, and the person that's packing up the suitcases and trying to live a kind of a life in between shrinks away. And I've experienced that balance between being the public person that is this monstrous type of diva personage and being a person trying to maintain my life, you know. So calling the album Diva is a little wink at that time, you know. I can make that distinction. I think there was a time when I found it very difficult to know who was who. Take me to the desert where there's got to be a whole heap of nothing for you and me. Take me to the desert, take me to the sand, show me the color of your right hand. Just the demand of having a success around you that has such momentum that you inevitably are keeping it up, keeping it up, keeping it up, and it goes and goes and goes, and ultimately it's your life. And it's like a bus that's, you're running after this bus and it's right in front of you, you can't quite keep up with it. You know, it shouldn't, to me, it shouldn't really be like that. But it's part of the process. It's part of the process of evolving and experiencing. And now I feel at the stage where I no longer have to be running after that bus. A period of severe embarrassment for me. That's not reflected on the people that I was with. It's only about myself, you know. Because in a way, that for me was a sort of learning ground, you know, where you kind of made your mistakes in public, if you like. And perhaps I feel now in retrospect that I should never have been in that group. I wasn't right for them, and they weren't really right for me probably either. And another really big lesson that we learned was that the music business attracts all kinds of entrepreneurial sharks. Because they're in it for the money, totally. They're not in it for the musical or artistic idea. I believe that anyway. I never for one instant think that the record companies are in it for anything else than making money. So Eurythmics was very wise by the time, you know, we'd had our fingers burnt. And we knew if we're going to survive, we've got to really keep an eye on everything, creatively and in a practical sense as well.
The incredible, the amazing, the transcendent Eurythmics!
Is this my turn? You want me to say?
Just one thing that I'm looking for.
the momentum comes and you go with it, you know. Before you know it, 10 years have passed and it's like, hang on a second, what happened to my life? I mean, I know that I was here and here and here and here. And it's funny because other people come up to you and they say, do you remember that time when I met you backstage in Munich? And you're going, well, not really, because you don't. It's just a big blur, really. I think actually after a while you have to go and sit on a mountain somewhere, or you're just not going to recharge your batteries. You're not going to have experiences to write about. So at a certain point, around about the last Eurythmics album, I really felt that's about all I could ever say. You know, I think I'd had it, really. We've decided not to work together indefinitely. It's getting very difficult. I mean, we never made any secret of the fact that the two of us had a very kind of tempestuous relationship, you know. It was very strained. And, I mean, we both wish each other the best and have the, you know, I mean, I hope that he will be successful and happy and fulfilled in his life, and I'm sure that he feels the same way about me. But I don't think there's any point in pursuing something when it's getting too uncomfortable for both of you. Do I miss Dave? Well, Dave, I'm not really missing you right now. No, because, you know, the two of us spent years together. You know, he doesn't miss me either. We just had such an intense time for those years. I mean, we've spent 500 years together, if you like, you know. It is like more than most married couples could even bear. So right at the moment, we don't miss each other. No, I mean, when I was writing, I mean, obviously, when he wasn't there, I definitely understood how well that partnership worked. And I mean, I always did anyhow, so much so that I didn't even think I could write a record without Dave. I mean, that was just unthinkable. But the challenge was there, you know, just to see whether it was possible.
When I was just 17, I ran away from home to be with all the pretty people, to be on my own, yeah. Bright lights and chains, and that's it stays, and pavements paved with gold. And I believed in everything that everybody told me.
Legend in My Living Room is a song about a person who never quite made it, and perhaps is bitter about that. And possibly it might have been that way for me, you know. I don't know. I mean, people ask me, what would it have been like if you hadn't formed Eurythmics with Dave and this and this and this? But the true answer is I really don't know. I mean, before I met Dave, I really had considered just going back to Aberdeen, because after all, let's be sensible about this. You're not going to meet anybody, and, you know, come on, you know, let's get real. I mean, and my father was, I remember my father was saying, well, you know, you could always come back to Aberdeen, and I was thinking, oh, God. Please, I don't want to go back to Aberdeen. I hated being at school latterly. In the last few years that I was at school, I was just like desperate to get out of that sort of institution, you know. And I thought, well, the only future for me is to be a teacher. Oh God, it'll kill me. So I'm really lucky that didn't happen, you know. They always say, oh, child, it's the best time of your life, you better enjoy it. Now I just think, oh, leave me alone. Surely life can't be that bad, you know. I just never really felt that I particularly belonged anywhere. It was yes, I mean, there was a feeling of that, but it wasn't like I felt terribly alienated or something. I don't think I really started to develop a sense of alienation until I was about 16, and then I definitely just felt misplaced around everybody. If you're going to be creative, better be off the wall. Better not be sitting in the middle of it all, feeling comfortable. I found this role that is performing and doing what I do, and it suits me very well, thank goodness. I would not like to feel as alienated as I feel and not have a possibility to use it constructively. Close to very slow, sad, melancholic songs. There's something that they play on the pipes, the bagpipes, called pibroch, and it's a lament. It's a thing that the piper used to play after the battle, let's say, when there would be a great period of grieving and mourning. And I feel that that pibroch is like, I'm almost like one of those, if I could play the bagpipes, I would be playing those songs. You know, they're very dear to me. Less edgy, it's less bitter, it's less angry. Perhaps it reflects a frame of mind that I have, which is just more fulfilled, perhaps more complete, you know, that I've got the hindsight of my experience rather than the misery of it, you know. I think it's very healthy place to be. Anybody that's had children, you know, if it's changed their life, they're going to have to tell you that it, you know, it has had some effect. It certainly brought certain qualities back into my life that I think had been missing for years, you know, a certain sense of joy and spontaneity and all manner of things. That's the beauty about children, is that the people that have children, they all know what that thing is. You know, you walk down the street and you see somebody else with a kid, you know, and you know that they know, and it's lovely. I would like to have more children, you know. I'm an only child, so I feel that I would like my child to have some siblings, even if it's not easy. Because I think that when you have other children close to you that you have to share with, then you get a better lesson for life than being the only one, you know, where the attention is focused on you. You have a rather imbalanced view of the world from that point of view. So that would be something that I would like, you know, but I now from experience understand that these things are not something that you can plan necessarily, or that you go to the supermarket and buy, you know. It doesn't work that like that, but it would be great, yeah. Songs that I've ever written and written with Dave have been intensely personal, because I am not the kind of songwriter that goes outside of myself looking at other people's situations and reinterpreting them in let's say some kind of story form. I love that way of songwriting, but it doesn't seem to apply to my own sort of ability, if you like. I always find that it's necessary for me to sort of confront myself.
Sweetheart, send me to sleep. Pray to God our hopes to keep. Take our fears and make us strong. Lead us to where we belong. And let it all go by.
To become very introspective to write a song, and a song that says anything of any quality or depth. Very good for wrinkles. I love to perform, you know. What can I tell you? And I find that actually the clothes that one wears help you to do that, you know, better. People say to me things like, well, now that your new image is da-da-da-da-da, and I've always found that hard question to deal with, because I sort of used some of those characterizations to deflect this sense of image, you know, to sort of avoid being categorized as such and just sort of limited to that one road where perhaps there would be no chance for me to change and develop.
What's cute about a little cutie? It's her beauty, not brave. Old Father Time will never harm you if your charm still remains. After you grow old, baby, you don't have to be a cold baby. Keep young and beautiful. It's your duty to be beautiful. Keep young and beautiful. You want to be loved.
It's a little bit of a little joke for myself, you know, because what I do is dealing with image and imagery so much. And perhaps from my time now, at my age, I want to continue, so it kind of irks me that women tend to be kicked to one side in a way when they get a little old to be called young.
Keep young and beautiful if you want to be loved.
I still feel that I have something to say, and it's incredible that men could go on doing what they do in my field until they're in their 50s. Undignified though it may be, I still want to do it, and Maybe I should know better.
If you're wise, exercise all the fat off. Take it off, over here, over there. When you're seen anywhere with your hat on, wear a Marcel wave in your hair.
When you're the female and you're the singer in a group, you get a lot of the attention. So Dave was sometimes neglected because all the attention goes on the face and on the female.
I'm thrown and overgrown with bliss. There must be an angel playing with my heart, yeah.
Dave's personality and my personality were so different. In a way, I was the straight man to him being the funny man, if you like. So people would be able to talk to you with Mick through Dave, because he was the gregarious one, he was the sociable one. Everybody could talk to him, and they could all call him up. Of course, this got very too much of responsibility for him ultimately. And I was always known as the difficult one, the heavy one, the one who said no. But in actual fact, most of the time, these decisions were reached by both of us, and it was probably quite useful that one of us was outgoing, the other one was kind of reserved, you know. And now I'm in the position where I have to kind of be both the funny man and the straight man, but I keep a distance still. I've just had 2 years when I wasn't talking to the media, when people did, you know, thought I just sort of disappeared. So things cooled down, and it was certainly fine. I mean, I found in myself that a certain tension that existed just as soon as I stepped out the door, or went into a supermarket, or went into a restaurant, or any kind of public place, with this tension, sometimes I would just leave, because I just couldn't, I knew that it was all going to be too much, too many eyes turned in my direction. So that's gone now, that's more or less evaporated. And just as it's gone, I'm inviting it to come back in again, in a way, about making a record.
Darling, don't you understand? I feel so ill at ease. The room is full of silence, and it's getting hard to breathe.
That experience of being the object of a certain kind of voyeurism is a very strange phenomenon. And so when we did this, when we went to St. Mark's Square and I dressed as the diva, it was very exposed, you know, just standing there literally for people to come up and take pictures. And then as I watched the results of that, there's that it really is that you can see as the viewer, the feeling of what it's like to be sort of, you know, it speaks for itself.
I need to go outside, I need to leave the smoke, 'cause I can't go on living in the same sick junk. It seems our lives have taken on a different kind of twist, now that you have given me perfect gift. You have given me the gift.
I don't want to be a media darling, and I don't want to live in the media, and I don't want to conduct my affairs on front covers, you know. I think there are periods when I must have a dalliance, you know. It's necessary. But the wonderful thing is that it stops and that I can go back and be quiet, you know. I don't have that hunger. I mean, Madonna said on the film that was made that doesn't everyone want power? And I mean, I hope that I haven't misunderstood what she said, but from what I can gather, I think I understood it pretty well. And I don't want that kind of power, because I wouldn't want the responsibility that comes with it, thank you, you know. Certainly not. What was the question?
This Thursday.